welcome here. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus to break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Sing it. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power.
Oh,
chain, break every chain, break every chain.
One more time.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
Jesus, Jesus.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
There's power.
There is power. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
I hear those chains falling. I hear those.
Surrender all.
Make that your prayer this morning. Sing it. I surrender.
To remember Era and Randy Roberts, Liz Farmer, Brent Atkinson, Lauren Borchelt, Dean Burleson, Barbara Denson, Pat Carroll, Sarah Freeman, Florence Felter, and James Anderson. And if you have a need in your life, if you'll just raise your hand, the Lord sees and the Lord knows, and He is able to touch and to move in these situations. Come on, somebody else. So, Lord, we just thank You this day, Father. We thank You for allowing us another opportunity, God, to gather in Your house this day, Father. Over these prayer requests, Father, we ask that You would touch, Lord, and that You would move, God, in those situations, Father. Lord, I thank You for the praise reports for these requests, God, that we are asking You to move and touch and intervene in the situations, Father. Over all the ones of people that lifted up their hands, God, in acknowledgement saying that they have a request for You, Lord, I ask that You would touch those as well, Father, and just move, God. And I thank You for the praise reports that we are going to receive of how You are moving and how You are touching, God, because I believe that You still move, God, and that You still deliver and that You still touch and You still heal, God. And I just thank You and I praise You for this, Father, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated.
She spins and she sways to whatever song plays without a care in the world. And I'm sitting here wearing the weight of the world on my shoulders. It's been a long day and there's still work to do. She's pulling at me saying that I need you. There's a ball at the castle. I've been invited, and I need to practice my dancing. Oh, please, Daddy, please. So I dance with Cinderella while she's here in my arms. She came home today with a ring on her hand, just glowing and telling us all they had planned. She says, Dad, the wedding's still 6 months away, but I need to practice my dancing. Oh, please, Daddy, please. So I'll dance with Cinderella while she is here.
Father's Day, and let me say to all the fathers in this place, Happy Father's Day. It's good to see you here today. I realize that Father's Day, unlike Mother's Day, falls during summer vacation. So we've got people gone on vacation, but we've got some that went to be with Dad today, and I bless them for that. But it's good to be in the presence of the Lord this day. And good to be with God's people. Could I take just a few minutes, and we'll go to the Word of God here momentarily. But have you enjoyed being in the presence of the Lord? And have you enjoyed the service thus far? Amen. And if there's one thing we learn, and I'm just trying to lighten the mood, because having a daughter, I don't like to think about wedding days. But we learned today that there's some people in this house that have some moves.
Yeah.
But it's good to celebrate. Time moves along. We can't stop time. But we certainly need to relish every moment. Amen? I think we need to relish every moment. And that doesn't mean just with our loved ones. That's true. But we need to relish every moment we have on this earth that we get to be together in the presence of the Lord. Because I'm trusting that everybody here is saved and redeemed by the blood of Jesus, because we'll be together for eternity. But I'm grateful that I know Him here, amen? And I know Him in the power of His resurrection, and that He's alive and well, amen? Come on, give Him praise today. Let's honor Him, amen? Amen. I'm going to do something just a little different this morning. Stay with me just a moment till I pray, because I'm not going to go to the text in the very beginning, but I'll get there. Would you bow your heads with me and let's just pray? Father, I thank You for this day today, and I thank You, Lord, for Your goodness, and I thank You for Your mercy and Your graciousness unto us. I thank You, Lord, for this day that we have to celebrate Jesus. Oh, Lord, that we can celebrate the life and resurrection that we have today. And I just praise You, Lord, because You're worthy of all things. And I pray that You would just let the meditation of my heart and the words of my mouth be acceptable in Your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Lord, just touch me this day. Anoint the hearts to hear, and may we bless Your name. It's in the lovely name of Jesus that I pray, and the church of the living God says, amen, amen. I want you just to bear with me a moment. I'm going to go to the book of Ezekiel here momentarily, but before I do, I'm going to ask you just a simple question, and I think I know the answer. How many of you here, I'm not setting you up, but I do want you to relate with this. How many of you here, you surf the web during the week? Look at that. Five people going to raise their hands in church because you think this is going to be a sermon on cell phones, no, or on computers. But how many of you have to use the web even in your job, or you surf the web? Come on, go ahead, raise your hands. It's okay. Now, one thing I've learned is we all appreciate and like technology as long as it works. But there's something occasionally that can happen. When you search for something on the internet or you're looking, you get that error message. Oh, there it is. Error 404. That's an error. The requested URL or server doesn't exist or was not found on this server. And look, Google. Google, who knows everything, says, that's all we know. And you say, what does this have to do with anything? Bear with me a moment. Because anyone that has ever surfed the internet or used the internet has seen this message. And the error 404 page is a hypertext, a transfer code to indicate that the browser was unable to communicate with a given server. Are you with me thus far? The browser was unable to communicate with a given server. You ever try to communicate with people and they don't understand? Or you call and you get a busy signal? Or you text and they don't reply? Or they've got it set to their privacy setting where it doesn't even show if they've read it? Come on, somebody. So it just kind of keeps you wondering. But it says that the browser was unable to communicate with a given server. But more importantly, it's that the server could not find that which was requested. Are you with me now? The server could not find that which was requested. And that brings me to something I want to draw your attention to in the Word of God. There's a prophet / priest that writes in captivity. His name is Ezekiel. Ezekiel is prominent and a prominent figure in biblical literature. But in chapter 22, verse 30, and I'll put this in context. Ezekiel 22, verse 30, there's an error code that comes up. There's an error code that comes up, actually, to our Lord. Imagine that. And it says this, so I sought for a man among them who would make a wall and stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land, that I should not destroy it. But I found no one. Leave that right there. Error 404. I sought for a man among them who would make a wall and stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land that I should not destroy it, but I found no one. Now today I'm going to speak to everybody. But specifically, this is applicable to everyone, but specifically to the men of this congregation. I found no one. Let me give you the context of what's happening here. Captivity has begun for Ezekiel. It's believed that Ezekiel wrote this book during his Babylonian captivity. The Babylonians took the Jews captive in three different waves. In three different periods. So Ezekiel is a priest living in Babylon as he writes under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Now, after Solomon's death, the kingdom of Israel was divided. That's what led up to this. The kingdom of Israel is divided. The northern kingdom was known as Israel, and the final capital of that, there being two previous, was Samaria. And the southern kingdom was known as Judah, with the capital being Jerusalem. So he speaks to Judah and Jerusalem in this passage. And in Ezekiel's chapter 20 through 24, predicts the fall of Jerusalem. So I'm just giving you the context of what's being said here. The fall of Jerusalem. And this is a bit of the context for the passage. But leading up to that, and why he writes this, is Judah is corrupt. Leaders were accepting brides and were self-centered. The priest had become consumed with things of this world and neglected God's work. Let's just pause there for a moment. And when I talk about priests, we could apply that to ministers. I mean this. I don't want to be so consumed by the things of this world that I neglect God's work. Hey, listen to me. I'm going to preach to you here just for a moment. Is that okay? I didn't get to preach last week. We had Beauty for Ashes here, and God blessed in that service. But I want to preach to you today. Is that all right? Because if it's not all right, I ask your permission, but I'm going to do it anyway. But as priest, a priest, of course, we consider the leader of a congregation. It assimilates even to a minister in this age. But a priest can also be the priest of their household. Now, I believe in women in leadership. No, don't start throwing thrones at me here, but let's just face it. If it wasn't for a lot of mamas, there'd be a lot of us that wouldn't be here today. Because some of you, it's only because of mama's prayer that you're here today. Because sometimes what happens, men, is we leave it to mama to take care of all the spiritual things, and we take care of bringing home the bacon. Why is it getting quiet in here? And the reason being is because we're more cultural than we are biblical. One thing I do every night, and even last night, I did it twice, and it's not because today is Father's Day, is I pray with my daughter, I pray over my daughter, I speak blessings over my daughter, because I'm telling you, I'm praying, and I know you're going, but I'm praying that the guy she brings home is not somebody I can't stand. So I'm praying right now, God, in your infinite wisdom, if you want to keep me out of prison, you send the right person along. Don't wait and pray after it's already happened. But my point is sometimes we neglect and men are bad. Well, listen, folks, we need men that will pray. We need men that are just like our women are warriors of God. Acts chapter 2 verse 17 talks about multi-generational and multi-ethnic and multicultural experience that in the last day, saith the Lord, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Amen. And with that being said, we need some men that will stand up and pray and shake the gates of hell. We need some priests that today that will stand up and be the man of God that God has called you to be. Not just that we make all kinds of excuses, and there's been thesis, and there's been biblical analysis, and there's been books written about this saying, well, men don't assimilate as well to serving God and serving in the modern church because we're made to be outdoor creatures. No, we were created in the likeness and the image of God. We are a spiritual being living in a temporal world. God has called us and raised us up for such a time as this. Amen. But let me move quickly here. But there's an issue. The priest had become consumed with the things of this world and neglected God's work. And not only that, you read in here, you'll find the prophets were liars. They were speaking that which the people wanted to hear. And instead of speaking about the things that were coming and the destruction that could come if there wasn't repentance, they would speak about peace as opposed to war, and they predicted victory when God said they would be defeated if they kept living the way that they did. They were telling of prosperous times to come when actually God was about to take away their possessions. The people of the land followed suit. There was no spiritual compass. They were falling into sin and would not repent. Thus, God was sending the word that, notice, he was searching for a man. I want you to notice, so I sought for a man among them who would make a wall and stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found none. So don't misunderstand. Don't miss it here. God was sending the word that he was searching for a man, and God would forgive these if they would repent. He's full of mercy. So the first thing I want you to notice is God is searching. Do you realize today, and especially men and women, but especially men, you may be the very person that God is desiring to use that someone is searching for? God uses his people to bring about his work and his word. God is seeking for those who would intercede and stand in the gap. And if I may pause here for a moment, we've got people in this culture who want to refute the scripture and the holy writ of God in this manner and say, well, you talk about a God of love and you talk about a God of peace, then why was God going to destroy people? It wasn't his will that any should perish. Because do you see this right here? He's wanting somebody to stand up and be accounted for and stand in the gap, but he finds no one. What are you saying? I'm saying that if you look right here, even though captivity has come, even though there's destruction on the way, God is looking for somebody to bring about his will and to stand and to intercede on behalf of the people and draw them under repentance. He is a God full of mercy. We got a culture right now that said, well, I don't buy that stuff. You know, you preach about that. But God, Jesus came preaching love. And people say, oh, yeah, that's true. That's not what he did preach love, but that wasn't his main message. His main message was this: the kingdom of God is at hand. He came first and foremost to preach the kingdom of God. He also preached love, and he also preached judgment. But we've got a culture that doesn't want to hear that. So I'm telling you today that God is searching for men that will stand up and intercede and be the man of God that he has called them to be, and therefore be a tool of God's mercy. And being a tool for God's mercy means this: that you may have to preach to your own household. Can I get on the soapbox just for a moment? It means you might have to say to your kids, honey, travel ball should be of lesser importance than God. It might be that you should say to your children that are in the dating era, listen, Don't just look for somebody that's good to you. Don't just look for somebody that has a good living. Look for somebody that serves the Lord with all of their heart. Look for somebody so you don't become unequally yoked. Now, it means we may have to preach to our own household. Why? Because God is looking for somebody. And the delay in God's judgment is because he does not want any to perish, so he's looking for people that would be accounted for. And specifically it says for a man. For a man to what? It doesn't mention that it has to be a man of great stature. He didn't say it had to be a man of social influence. Do you know what? It didn't even say that he had to be a man that was schooled in the knowledge of the Torah. Didn't say any of that. Because here's what we say. Didn't say that it had to be a young man. Here's the problem in the church. We've got elders that think they need to take a seat and a back seat because younger people need a place in ministry. Hold on. Younger people do need a place in ministry, but they need elders who have wisdom that will help guide them in that place of ministry. Say, well, now listen, I understand. If you want to leave it to the younger people to shout and jump when they do praise and worship, that's fine and dandy. I realize that unless I get under the unction of the Holy Spirit, I can't do everything that I did when I was 18. By the way, I found this new knee pain right here in the last few days. I woke up the other morning. I told Angela. I told her the other day. I said, you know, I woke up and, man, my knee's kind of catching. I don't know what that's all about. And I sat there and I thought, well, you know, now I'm over 40. Few years. And when a house reaches my age, floorboards creak a little bit, and, you know, there might be some termites in the temple. And I said that because we think, man, let the younger people do it. I understand. I'm not asking you. I realize that. I get it. I watched my mom's mother growing up in the church, and she could shout with the best of them when the Holy Spirit moved upon her. It's the truth. But if the Holy Spirit wasn't moving, she wasn't either. Because when she got older, come on, folks, bear with me a moment. When she got older, it was harder. I understand, folks. I get the picture that the older we get, things change in this physical body. But I also understand that we need the elders full of wisdom to help guide this generation. That's the problem right now. We've got too many people. We've got too many men in the church sitting back saying, let somebody else have a go at it for a while, when they need to be helping direct and lead. We need spiritual fathers and mothers of the faith in the body of Christ. He said he's not looking for the youngest. He's not looking for the most schooled. He's just looking for somebody to stand in the gap. You know what the gap is. The gap is a hole. It's a breach. It's a breach in their relationship with God. The language that is used here is in reference to a wall. Because in ancient times, a wall was the line of defense that was built around a city. It was a fortress. It's a wall. Everybody here lives in a home that has walls. Walls keep the wind out, unless you got cracks. Walls keep the rain out. Walls, when you lock that door and arm your security system, it's made to keep intruders out. So the language is used in reference to a wall. In ancient times, the wall was a line of defense. The wall kept things and people safe within its confines, yet the wall also kept things out that could harm them or decimate those that were in its confines. The wall here is symbolic. He's not talking. Now I want you to notice something. He is not talking about the physical problems in Judah and Jerusalem. He's not. Because they're already facing the battle. There's already been a first wave of captivity. He's not talking about that. He's talking about in the spiritual sense. The wall is symbolic, not literal. It symbolizes divine protection. And what he's saying is nobody here, there is not a man here that cares about divine protection, and they're just all laying back. Now, and with that, when there's a gap in our spiritual life that we don't seek the divine, guess what happens in the gap or the hole? Things come in that shouldn't be there. Divine protection. He seeks those that will stand in the gap. I thought of this morning, because this morning we were in the hallway and Lorelai was crawling around out here, and she got loose. And when she got loose, she found an electrical socket outlet. Come on, folks. We all know as a kid, those were enticing. No. You better come, because I'm feeling the unction to close. Listen, you want to get people to shout in the church? Give them a fork and talk them into sticking it into an electrical outlet. You say, where are you going with this? I'm going somewhere. You got to bear with me. She got loose. And the minute she started to reach for it, I saw hands, I saw Miss Crystal, and I saw her mother, everybody willing to get in the gap.
That's right.
Let's talk about this for a moment. Because if she'd really got a hold of that thing, it would lit her up like the 4th of July. And it wouldn't have been a good thing. That little body against that much force? Do you understand what I'm trying to tell you today? The devil is a liar. And the enemy cometh not but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. And he won't always do the obvious and come through the front door. But he'll try to get in the gaps, the holes, the breaches, and the cracks. And there needs to be some men and women of God that's going to stand up and say, not here, not today. Why? Because you serve the Lord God Almighty, and the Bible tells us that the Lord, you don't even have to do it. You just use His word. But the Lord rebuked the strong man. And I've got to close here. But it says this, so I sought for a man among them who would make a wall and stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land, that I should not destroy it. But I found no one. Now wait just a minute. There were men present. There were men available. But there were not men that would be employed. Sound familiar? They had excused themselves. If you read through this book closely in chapters 20 through 24, you will find they had excused themselves. Why? Just like in the book of Malachi, and even in the book of Habakkuk, and I believe even in Haggai, where it talks about the building of the temple, but I believe it may be in Malachi or Habakkuk, one of those where he mentions, he's like, to those people, he said, you live in paneled houses while the house of the Lord is in ruin. What are you saying here? They had excused themselves. Why had they excused themselves? Because it sounds just like the culture of today. They were wanting a better house. They were building houses. They were plowing the fields. Finally, finances had taken their priorities. Now, I understand, we got to have a living. We need a dwelling to live in. But you know one thing I've learned with children? Especially when they're young. They don't notice how much money you make. You may be able to afford a PlayStation 5 every Christmas. All they want is to play with the box that it came in. You say, what do you mean? It's not always the gift. That's the box that Dad gave me. We aspire to build bigger houses. It doesn't matter how big the house is. Not to your kid. What matters is Dad there. I truly believe that's why heaven's going to be what heaven is. You know, 1,500 miles wide and 1,500 miles deep, the breadth is as long as the depth. But the point is, I really don't believe I'm going to be concerned when I get there how deep and how wide it is. I really don't think all the things that glimmer and shine in heaven are going to matter. What's going to matter is as long as my Father's there. And the reason my Father is there is because He stood in the gap and built up the hedge that the cross was raised. And my redemption was bought and paid for with a price. Amen. But they'd excuse themselves. Houses, fields, finances, those things in themselves, they're not wrong. But they're consumed with such. Because the problem was that which they owned them. And then God called, and none would answer. Thus comes the wrath of God. And this could all have been avoided if people would and will repent and someone stand in the gap and be accounted for. See, as I close, what if that problem, what if that issue that comes through your door or comes into your life, what if the only thing that needs to happen is you stand up and pray against it to stop it? What if that's the case? What if the miracle God wants to work through is actually working through your will and your volition? What if the next thing that may happen, not what God foreordains, but that which God foresees, do we understand that if we're in tune with God and have discernment, that sometimes God warns us we see things? Anybody believe that? Because I'm going to tell you, I don't care if you're Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterian, Pentecostal. If you read this word, you will find that God speaks to His people, and you may not know the exact instances coming, but He will forewarn you. But what if that God foresees, He prepares you for, and all you've got to do is stand up? Stand up. That's all it takes. So I sought for a man among them who would make a wall, stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found no one. We've got this body. We've got these people. We've got more than what's here today. We're accountable. Men, I'm talking to you. Men, we're accountable. I'm standing right here today Anybody with me? I'm standing right here today, and I'm going to stretch my hand over this house. And I'm going to believe not only those sitting in the pew today, but those that will sit here in the future. We're going to stand in the gap. We're going to be... I'm going to pray that God, if you can use me, if I can be a tool that can help anybody and relieve anybody from destruction that may be coming their way, God, I pray that you use me. I pray, God, let me speak the truth every day. Anybody with me? Oh, no, man. I mean, anybody with me? Well, God's calling somebody right now to come up here because we're going to pray. Anybody with me? Maybe you're not a father, but maybe you're a spiritual father. Is God speaking to you today? Come on, stand up here with me. I believe that God is speaking today. He's speaking at this moment. Anybody with me? He's calling right now saying, come. Come on, man. Where are you at? Anybody with me today? Hey, maybe you've endured some things in your family, but anybody, you say, well, Pastor, it's too late for me. It's not too late. God is calling right now. He is speaking. Anybody with me? If you're physically able in body, come on, anybody with me today? We're going to stand in the gap. We're going to believe. I'm not trying to prod you. I'm not trying to poke you. I'm not trying to make you do anything. But church, I'm going to tell you something. We had a drug and recovery addiction program here last week. I'm tired of seeing the devil try to steal, kill, and destroy that which is God's. Oh, listen, your children, your grandchildren, the people of this body are not created as a tool for the enemy or the devil. You were made in the image and the likeness of God. God has called you, and he's raised some men up for a time such as this. I'm going to ask you, gentlemen, oh, look at this. Come on, somebody give him praise in this house. God is calling, and people are answering. Hey, let's do this. Stop right where you're at if you can. Just kind of spread on around. Go ahead. Spread on around this way. Spread on around just a little bit. Come on. Let's get around the front and around the sides because we're going to do something right now in the name of Jesus. Oh, can you spread on a little more this way? Go on. Yeah, keep on going. Let's get it all covered right here. Let's just get it covered. Oh, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Oh, imagine this. I know this is not a liturgical holiday. I know this is a Hallmark holiday, but we're celebrating today. First of all, we're celebrating Jesus. And we're going to celebrate. We're going to give thanks to God. Thank you, Lord, for these men that have gathered up here today. Thank you, Lord, for those that will be subservient to your call. Thank you, God, right now for what you're doing in the hearts of these that are here. Because, God, it took courage. It took strength. God, it took their will to get them up here to be obedient to your will for them to come. And, Lord, today I pray, God, your blessing and your touch upon them. But before we do anything else, God, I just pray we give you thanks. And I pray we honor you today for the men of this house, for the men of this society, for the men that are called right now, for the men, God, that you can use to make a difference in this world. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We praise your name. We honor you, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. In Jesus' name. Men, I'm going to ask you to do something with me. I want you to stretch your hand over this congregation. Just stretch your hand toward these pews. Come on, right now. And we're going to begin to pray. I'm not going to lead you. I'm not going to tell you what to say. But I want you to pray. And church, right now, I want you to lift your hands as receiving unto God which they're praying for you. Come on, just lift your hands. Let's pray. Come on, man, let's pray. Let's lift our voice in prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus. Father, touch them today. Speak, Lord Jesus, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus.
I'll go with him.
God, bring healing to this house. Lord Jesus, bring healing to situations. I pray that you put families in order. I ask that you give mental clarity. Lord, I just pray that you do the work that only you can do. I pray for miracles, Lord.
to be done in the lives of these, Lord, that we pray for. God, I pray for those that are unable to be here this morning, God, those that may sit in these pews should you tarry your coming. God, that your blessing would be upon them, that you lead and you direct. God, I pray that let conviction rain down in this house every time that we meet, God, that those that are lost, those that are seeking, Lord, that they would come to know you. Oh, Father, be glorified. Lord, I pray, God, help us to be the priest and the men of this society. Lord Jesus, to stand side by side
with him
as sons with the daughters of God. And Lord, to do what you've called us to do. Lord, be glorified in our lives. Be glorified. The devil is a liar. Lord, you rebuke the devil and you bind him. The strong man is not welcome here. In the name of Jesus right now, Lord, I pray that you loose them and let them go. Oh, God, right now I pray for children. I pray for grandchildren. I pray for generations, God, that you loose them. You let them go, Lord. Oh, Father, break every chain that binds. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Jesus' name I pray. God, minister to these. Touch us, Jesus. Jesus' name I pray. Jesus' name I pray. Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Oh, Father, have your way. Be glorified. Be glorified. Be glorified.
Me.
Thank you, Lord. Stay with me just a minute. I'm not trying to keep you here. I'm not. But I want you to see something. There are men up here worshiping and praising. And I need to point something out from the passage. Well, one thing from the passage that we need to note is, first and foremost, is that worship is public. There's private worship, but worship is public. Old Testament worship was public worship because they went to the temple to worship. They evangelized outside the temple when they'd proselyte converts. But worship was public. This scripture is about the public seeing a man. It's not just about being seen because I'm a worshiper. It's about being seen that I stand against what's going on in society. I stand against the work of the enemy. I stand against the lack of integrity among what's being done in the temple. I stand up today because I don't believe in the work of the enemy. So what needs to be noticed here today is these men are standing here today publicly saying, I denounce what the enemy is trying to do to my family. I denounce what he's trying to do in my church. I denounce what he's trying to do in my life. So today, this is what we need to see. It's good to teach your sons. It's good to teach your daughters life skills and things like that. But they need to see dad worship publicly. So right now, before we leave this place, it's not just about you doing what the pastor says. It's about doing what is right unto God. God's been better to you, every one of you, than you've been to him. He's preserved you for a time such as this. He's called you for a time such as this. So I'm asking you right now, man, it might be uncomfortable for some. It may not be, but would you lift your hands right now all over this place and in this house, and men begin to praise him and thank him for his goodness and his mercy upon your life. Thank him for your family. Come on, just begin to worship him. Just begin to honor him. God bless you. Thank
you. There's an army rising up.
home.